Today's video is going to be all about infrared landscape photography, which has been a bit of a mini summer project for me that I haven't yet shared, probably because I'm a bit scared, because I'm a bit of a newbie when it comes to infrared, a bit of a noob. But I thought it'd be really interesting to put this video together nonetheless. Now, we're very much in the dying phases of summer now. To be honest, it feels like summer's gone. You might be able to tell, I am wearing a hat today. It's rather cold, but we do have some nice, strong sunlight today and some nice cloud coverage up in the sky too, which usually works very well for infrared photography in my limited experience. Now, I'm not gonna hold myself out to be any kind of IR expert, but I thought it would be good to put this video together nonetheless and share the experiences and the knowledge that I have picked up so far from this mini project. So, before we actually get stuck into the photography, I better actually explain what infrared photography actually is and how it works. I'm certainly no scientist, so this will be very concise and simplified. The spectrum of visible light that our eyesight and standard photography captures runs from approximately 400 to 700 nanometers, with infrared light starting at around 700 nanometers and above. The sensors in our cameras are equipped with filters which reduce the amount of infrared light which reaches the sensor, thereby helping to create more true-to-life visible light exposures. Therefore, to capture infrared with digital cameras, we have two main options available. The first is infrared conversion, where the filters applied to the camera's sensor are removed or modified. Overall, this is the best option, enabling infrared light to be photographed without massively long exposures being required. However, it does mean sacrificing a camera to the conversion process, making it potentially expensive. The second option is to use an infrared filter on a standard unmodified camera, which only allows infrared light to pass through. As the filters on the sensor are still very much in place, the IR signal reaching the camera sensor will be extremely weak, resulting in very long exposures being necessary. This approach is obviously far less flexible and requires the use of a tripod at all times. However, it is cheaper and more accessible for those looking to dip their toes into infrared photography. This is the approach I have taken by using a Hoya R72 filter, which filters everything below 720 nanometers. So why does infrared photography particularly appeal to me? Well, I think the reason for that is how it renders particular landscape objects and scenes completely differently to normal visible light. The best example and the main reason that people get drawn to infrared photography is how it renders vegetation. The greens in vegetation punch out very vibrantly and brightly, almost gives a snow-like quality to vegetation, and that's because it reflects a lot of infrared light. So if you're taking pictures of trees and grass, for example, it will glow very brightly within the scene. But also, and probably something that appeals to me more so than the vegetation side, is how it renders blues in scenes. It tends to render them very dark, almost black within a scene, and that can look fantastic in blue skies like we've got today. And for that reason, I've been really attracted to black and white high contrast infrared photography rather than the color infrared photography, which can kind of look a little bit sort of, it's an acquired taste, it looks a bit odd, shall we say. I might get round to testing that in the future, but for me, my focus is black and white. So this behind me is my first location today. This is called Foxdale Mines, and it's quite an iconic building that just sits in the middle of nowhere here up in the hills of the Isle of Man. And I think it's going to work really well for a focal point in the image. I've been really attracted to architecture with the infrared photography that I've taken so far, and I think this building wields a lot of potential. So what I'm simply doing is placing it bang center in the middle of my composition and kind of dedicating the bottom third of the image to the ground and then the top two thirds at least to the sky above. Now what's really attractive today is actually what's going on in the sky, because that's the real star of the show. There's quite a strong wind. You might have noticed just in the background noise, there's quite a strong wind today, and it's blowing across the scene here, and all of these fluffy clouds that you can see here are going at quite a rate across the scene here. So with a long exposure here, I should be able to pick up nice cloud movement across that sky, and the infrared here, it should really draw down the colour in that blue there and create a real strong and heavy contrast in that sky. I think the effect should be quite nice, and also any of the vegetation down sort of around the bottom of the building here should glow quite brightly, which again will just deepen that contrast throughout the scene. You can see my camera just set up here over my shoulder. It's actually taking a long exposure right now. And settings wise, I'm shooting this at f10, ISO 64, 24mm, and a very long shutter speed of about 5 minutes, which should be perfectly sufficient to pick up plenty of movement across the scene. How that image has turned out. I think the cloud movement across the scene looks terrific and really makes the shot. And it really reinforces to me why I love infrared photography so much, or certainly why I've grown to love it very quickly. And that's because it really unlocks lighting conditions and shooting hours which we would usually shun as landscape photographers. So in landscape photography, usually the moment the light gets harsh, I'll pack up my things and head home. But infrared photography completely flips that on its head, because those harsh lighting conditions are conducive to getting the best infrared photography results, because it deepens the contrast within scenes and makes vegetation glow that more strongly within the scene. So I've found that infrared photography complements my usual landscape photography really well, because I can shoot my usual landscape stuff around sunrise, sunset and the golden hours, etc. But then I can come out in harsh light like this and still unlock those shots by using and leveraging infrared. I've travelled to a different location and I've found my second composition for the day, which is just behind me here. I've got my camera set up and it's pointing towards Peel Castle, which is one of the most famous landmarks on the Isle of Man. And really, this composition is all about layers. In the foreground of my shot, I've got some vegetation here, which will be rendered very bright in the scene. Then I've got some water, which will be rendered kind of inky black by the infrared. Then the actual castle, which sits on a little island out in the middle of the sea, that's got plenty of vegetation and grass on it, which again will be rendered very bright. And then the sky above it, the blue sky, which will be rendered very dark. So we should get some nice layers going back through the shot. The only thing that's going against me now is we don't have very much cloud texture and detail in that sky. And in my experience, I don't particularly like shooting infrared when we've got nothing going on in the sky above there. So I think I'm just gonna have to hold tight, wait, and see if we get any clouds blowing in through the scene. From the infrared experimentation that I've done, I figured out that the Hoyer filter cuts out about 15 stops of light on my camera. So that is a massive light reduction. But that's not hard and fast rule, because that differs from camera to camera depending on the inherent sensitivity of the camera sensor to infrared light. But generally speaking, when I set up a composition, that's what I work out my exposure for. But even so, I have actually found that some circumstances it seems to be cutting out less light, and some circumstances it seems to be cutting out more light. So that isn't particularly all that accurate, but it at least gives me a good starting position in which to base my exposure around. I'll take a few test shots and kind of work it out from there. A little bit of trial and error I tend to find with infrared. But the obvious consequence of this is that when using the Hoyer filter, unless I really open my aperture up wide or smash my ISO really high, all my exposures are going to be extremely long in duration. And this has had the consequence of me altering the kind of compositions and subject matters that I'm shooting. Generally, most infrared photography will focus on taking pictures of trees because they look absolutely amazing. But I find that a real struggle with this filter, because I live on the Isle of Man. It's probably one of the windiest places in the British Isles. So that vegetation, the leaves and the trees, when they're sort of blurring around in those long exposures, really don't look that appealing to me. So generally I've been avoiding taking pictures of trees, and instead I'm focusing as my focal points and images on buildings, because they don't move around much in the wind. And generally I think that actually works better with this filter, unless I'm gonna smash my ISO really high and add a lot of noise and image degradation into my photography. Another challenge of infrared photography is focusing, because infrared focuses on a different focal plane to visible light. And this means that quite often if you focus in for visible light, then your images will just look slightly soft, because the actual infrared focusing plane is just slightly in front or behind where you've actually focused. Having said that, in my experience, I haven't found focusing all that difficult at all. I'm not sure what's going on here. I did a bit of research, and I think it might have something to do with the fact that I'm using a mirrorless camera, because from what I know, mirrorless cameras are generally better for infrared focusing, because they do their focusing on the image sensor, and that makes them more accurate. I mean, I'm not an expert in this area, but my limited research has suggested this, and certainly my experiences using the Z7 here, it's had absolutely no issues whatsoever. If you do find that you're struggling with focusing in infrared, then what I'd suggest is just make little micro adjustments manually to your focusing ring and take a few test shots until you get it just where you want it. Now, a phenomenon called hotspots with infrared, and this is where you get an overexposed circle in the middle of your image, and it tends to render itself more clearly in your images when you shoot those narrow apertures, and it softens quite considerably using wider apertures. Now, hotspots differ from lens to lens. The lenses that I'm using, the Nikon 14-30 and the 24-70, generally hotspots have been no issue whatsoever on those lenses, which potentially further kind of evidences the quality of these lenses. But you may find on the lenses that you have and other sort of builds, manufacturers, etc., that you do get hotspots appearing in the middle of your images. And if you do encounter that problem, then just widen your apertures a little bit and it should soften that away. White balance is another potential area which can cause some serious issues with infrared photography. I'm not going to lie, this is an area that's confused me quite a lot, because there seems to be a lot of contradicting information out there. All I can tell you is, based on my experience, I haven't actually found it to be that much of an issue with my black and white processing. And general best advice out there is to take a custom white balance reading for any vegetation you've got in your scene. So point your camera at some grass, for example, and then take the white balance reading off that, because then that will render any vegetation in your scene white, which is generally what you want with infrared photography. Now, I think for this composition, I want to try and freeze the clouds as best I can within the sky. I don't want to get that extreme long exposure streaking kind of look that I got on the first shot. So to achieve that, I'm going to need to raise my ISO higher than I usually would. So for this shot, I'm going to be shooting at ISO 500, f10, and at 24mm. And generally that will give me exposure length of about 30 seconds in order to expose this properly, which of course is going to give me a degree of movement in those clouds, but it's not going to be that extreme long exposure style from the first image, which was 5 minutes in duration. After a painfully long wait, the clouds did finally kind of play ball, although they weren't exactly how I would have wanted them within the scene, but you've just got to work with what you're given. But ultimately I'm quite pleased with how that image has actually turned out there. What I would say on infrared photography is it's not for everyone. It's a bit of a Marmite kind of subject. Some love it, some hate it. I think I'm grown to love it. I really like that eerie, ethereal, kind of ghostly have, and they really feel quite unique to any kind of visible light images that I've ever taken before. And I think it's a really nice way as a landscape photographer to kind of access those shooting hours during the middle of the day that we usually shy away from. So I personally would highly recommend giving it a try, and Hoya filter is a great and affordable way to do so. If you want more details on that filter, just look below in the description. So that's a wrap for today's infrared video. Hopefully I'll have more infrared content at some point in the future once I've honed my skills down a little bit more. But if you do have any thoughts on the images I captured today, or just generally infrared photography, by all means pop your comments down below. I'd be really interested to hear from anyone who's more experienced at it than me, their insights on the subject, because I think it's a very challenging and technical niche within landscape photography, but I think that makes it all the more exciting personally. But yeah, that's it for today. So thanks very much for joining me, and I'll see you all soon. Take care.